I think we are live now. So, a very good morning to all the participants of the session today. I welcome you all to the third day of this workshop on building proficiency in academic writing. Today, with us, we have Professor Lakshmi Raj Sharma to grace us with his presence. Professor Lakshmi Raj Sharma, an author, novelist, and academician of the Indian origin, is a professor at the Department of English and Modern European Languages at the University of Allahabad. Professor Sharma had his early and secondary education schooling from the Boys High School and College, Allahabad. He entered the University of Allahabad in 1973, graduated in 1975, and then completed his master's in 1977. He received the Doctor of Philosophy Award from the same Allahabad University in 1986. He was also selected for the Indian Civil Services, but opted for an academic career. Professor Sharma believes that a person who is placed in somewhat weak positions in the society can make a better narrator than the one who is well-placed or confident. The deprived, the oppressed, and sometimes even the nervous or anxious make good narrators in a work of fiction. His writing is often marked by a viewing of the world through a man or woman who feels unsettled or unsure of themselves. Some of his literary works include Saba and Nisha, a love story, Interviewing Women, Marriages Are Made in India, and The Tailor's Needle. Today, he is going to deliberate on academic and other forms of writing, indeed a very deep topic. Before I request Professor Sharma to initiate his talk, I must thank him for continuing with his commitment and not cancelling his talk, despite of the fact that he came to know last evening that all his family members except him, and including a granddaughter, little granddaughter, tested positive for COVID-19. We wish for the speedy recovery of all of them. Sir, your professional commitment has inspired us to great levels. And we thank you for joining us today. Now, I would request you to kindly address the audience, sir.
Good morning to all of you. I'm very thankful to NIT Sikkim and the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, to the Director, Professor Mahesh Sri Govil, and to all the other organizers, including my own student, Dhananjay Tripathi, for inviting me here. I must say that this conference is on a very, very useful subject, building proficiency in academic writing. It is a very difficult topic, I must say, and it might seem simpler than it is, in fact. It is very easy to tell you certain qualities of academic writing. That is the most simple thing one can do. But what I would like to tell you about academic writing is that actually it is not very different from other forms of writing. And therefore, I'm giving you this talk on academic and other forms of writing. In order to be contemporary, you must know that the world is not as simple as it seems. I hope I'm audible to all of you.
Yes, okay. Yes, sir, you're audible, sir. You're audible to everybody.
Thank you very much. The world is not as simple as it seems to be. The contemporary world has posed a lot of problems before us, because of which the meaning of meaning has changed. whatever we consider to be meaning may not actually be the meaning of that thing. The dictionary might give us one meaning of a word, but that word may have several connotative meanings. That means it might have several layers of meaning. And the contemporary world tells us that we should not believe that we can communicate meaning very easily. Therefore, the work of academic writing has become much more complicated than it ever was. And we cannot take what contemporary theories tell us very lightly, because they tell us something very despairing. They tell us something very nihilistic, something which makes us very hopeless, that we actually cannot communicate effectively. We cannot convey what we want to convey very effectively. And this is a very depressing thought. What I am telling you at this present moment may not actually be reaching you in the form in which I want it to reach you. And so, I'm just struggling to do something which I may not actually be doing. And therefore, writing and speech and anything that involves language is not as simple as it seems to be, because language is made up of signs. Language is a system of signs, signs, not science. Language is a system of signs, signs. And those signs can have different, you know, connotations, different significations to different people. So even in academic writing, it is very important that we do not presume that what we say is going to be understood exactly as we want it to be understood. So this is the very first premise of my lecture. And while you think on this for half a minute, and while I sip, you know, a little water, I want you to be conscious of the fact that writing is not as simple as it seems to be. Even academic writing is not as simple as it has been made out to be by some scholars. I'm extremely impressed by Professor K.K. Agarwal, who gave the keynote address, because he could, you know, pinpoint the importance of academic writing. He called it community writing. Now, this is the view of someone who is very, very well read, because this view is also the view of a postmodernist theorist, you know, called Lyotard, who calls academic writing, not only academic writing, but all kinds of discursive writings, you know, writings that are generated in communities. And this is an important fact for you to remember, that every subject becomes like a vast community of people who use a particular kind of writing, who use a certain kind of terminology, and therefore they generate a certain kind of discourse. And I will talk to you about discourse in several stages of my lecture today, because discourse is very, very significant in every academic writing. Okay. So first of all, I would just like to tell you something. That when we think of writing, we compare it automatically with speech. And the contemporary theorist, Derrida, has considered these to be binaries of each other. They are binary opposites of each other, speech and writing. Speech is what gets privileged always. And this is a very important fact. Why do we consider speech more important than writing? We consider speech to be more important than writing because there is a speaker before us who is using his body language, his voice, his intonation, his volume, and his very presence to make you understand what he's trying to say. So speech gets privileged. But unlike speech, writing is very different. It is different because the person who has written this is absent from the scene. And because he is absent from the scene, people do not pay that much attention to what he has written down. So you see, writing is something which is more difficult than speaking for most people, because the writer has to come alive through his writing in order to impress the reader. He has to bring himself out of his writing and almost present himself there like a speaker. It is only then that the writer will be read, his audience will be established, and his job is therefore more difficult than a speaker's, because a speaker with his sheer volume can make you listen. But the writer has to substitute something for that volume, for that body language, etc. So the nature of writing itself needs to be understood. And then only can we understand the fact that academic writing needs to be what every other kind of writing needs to be, because every kind of writing wants to be read. Every kind of writer wants to have readers, wants that there should be people paying attention to what they are writing. But it is not easy for the academic writer to get that attention from people, because writing is something dead until it can be awakened by the interest of the reader. And this interest is not easy to get into the writer, into the reader. All right, so basically, academic writing should aim at one object. It has several qualities, but its aim is always to convey knowledge. The conveying of knowledge is the first and the last goal of academic writing. So, because I'm going to talk about academic writing, and I'm going to talk about other forms of writing, therefore, I must make it clear at the outset that for academic writing, the most important objective is, the most important aim is to convey knowledge. Now, knowledge has meaning. You know, knowledge means facts. It means meaning. It means contexts. It means several other things. And contemporary theories of understanding tell us that it is virtually impossible for us to convey this meaning clearly, because the real meaning of anything is always postponed. So the academic writer must know that the knowledge that he is trying to convey has to be conveyed not only by putting facts together, not by, you know, not as a scientist, just put so many facts together. Because how many of those facts are understood? That is important. And understanding is a very, very, you know, very fluid matter. We don't understand something like a solid object is understood when we feel it and we see it and we hear its sound when it is dropped. You know, knowledge is a much more fluid thing. It is a much more liquid thing. And the job of the academic writer is to try to make it as solid as he can do. He may not be able to do it absolutely successfully. He may not be able to make himself absolutely understood. But the effort should be made. That is what contemporary theories of understanding and knowledge tell us. So I'm going to tell you something first about, you know, this postmodernist thinker called Jean-Francois Lyotard, who tells us about two major types of discourse. The word discourse, you know, is a very complicated word. And it has several meanings. If you look up the dictionary, you will find several meanings of discourse. So, but remember, there's one important meaning of discourse, which you must be clear about. And that is that every discipline, every subject has its own language, its own discourse. That means discourse is connected with the language of a subject. That means there are certain hidden things for the general reader, which are not so hidden for the reader of a particular subject. So discourse means a certain kind of contextualized meaning. Discourse is much more than simple meaning. The dictionary meaning of a word may be very simple, but its discursive meaning may be different. I'll give you an example of this. There are about 100 people listening to me at this moment in this conference. Suppose I stop and point my finger at any one of you and just ask you a simple sentence. What is your name? This sentence will have one simple meaning and it will also have a discursive meaning. The simple meaning is very simple. What is your name? I don't need to tell you. But there is a discursive meaning of this sentence also. Why am I singling out a particular person for this question? Am I interested in the gender of that person? Am I interested in the caste of that person? Am I interested in the region, nationality, or race of that person? Why am I asking this particular person this question? Like, what is your name? Is not as simple as it seems to be.
It's not as simple as it seems to be. It is much more complicated. And this is why I need to tell you that discursive knowledge is important, and we must keep track of the discursive knowledge, the discursive language of a subject. Now, according to Lyotard, there are two kinds of knowledge. One is scientific knowledge, and the other is narrative knowledge. And the second is very important. Scientific knowledge is associated with every subject. It's basic, factual kind of knowledge. But every subject has a narrative knowledge as well. And it is this narrative knowledge which gives a subject its discourse. And therefore, when you write a thesis, when you write a book of an academic nature, or when you write a thesis, it is very significant that you know that your work must have a narrative. A narrative means telling something in a certain way. You know, a narrative is not factually true, but it is what you believe to be true because it is your thesis. It may not be factually true. Maybe tomorrow you will be proved wrong. But it is your thesis. For you, it is true. Just like when someone tells a story, that I am a novelist and I tell a story, that story is fiction, no doubt. But I have to tell it in a manner as if it were true, as if there is no lies in it. Otherwise, no one will read my story. So in academic writing also, you have to put on the guise of being absolutely true. Then you speak in a voice of authority. You have to speak with a voice of authority in your academic writing. If you do not speak with in the voice of authority, then the reader will not take you very seriously. Now, in order to build that voice of authority, you have to link with yourself with the scholarship that has existed before you. Why? Because you cannot write anything academic in isolation. You have to become a part of the general ocean of knowledge which exists in your subject. You have to become a part of that. And in order to become a part of that, you have to link yourself at a particular point of what has been said in the past and what is to come in the future. You are the bridge between what is to come and what has already come in that discipline. Your academic writing has to be the bridge between the past and the future. You are the present. And you are the bridge. If you are weak, then you will not be able to link the past and the future, and your academic work will collapse, and you will be thrown out from the mainstream of the academic field in which you write. So building up a strong narrative is a very essential part of writing. So, what is a strong narrative? A strong narrative means telling your story very effectively. That means being very analytical and very critical. But at the same time, you have to write give something very personal in your writing in an impersonal manner. Remember, and this is a kind of a, you know, it is a kind of a religion for an academic writer, that you must be able to merge the personal with the impersonal. The impersonal comes from the past, whatever the great writers of the past have said. You cannot ignore them. You have to accommodate them also in your writing. But at the same time, you cannot just repeat what they have said. You have to go beyond them. So you become the link with the past, and then you will be the link to the future. So the best kind of writing is a combination of the personal with the impersonal. The best academic style combines the personal and the impersonal. So you should have the maximum of personality combined with the maximum of the impersonality. That means you should be yourself, no doubt, but you should also go out of yourself into the worlds of other writers, other scholars, other philosophers, other scientists, other knowledge givers, because you are also going to give knowledge just as they have given knowledge. You just cannot forget them. You cannot say these are old-fashioned writers. I will not take them into account. No, you have to. Because later on, you may discover that they are still much more in fashion than you will be in the future. So you have to maintain your link with the past so that the future maintains its link with you. That is a very important part of academic writing. Now, I'm giving a 15-minute pause so that you think about this, because it is a very important part of academic writing. All right. So, writing has, you know, can involve two kinds of knowledge. One is scientific knowledge, the other is narrative knowledge. All right? And narrative knowledge has its own discourse. And this discourse is very, very essential. Every subject has its own discourse. If we think of gossip as a subject, then even gossip has its own discourse. It has its own kind of narrative. Someone who wants to give you knowledge through gossip will use narrative in another way, in another manner. A historian will use narratives in another manner. A writer of economics will use narrative in another manner. Every kind of academic writer will use narratives in another manner. So remember, every thesis must have a narrative. Just putting points together in your thesis means nothing. That is just scissors and paste. That will not make your academic writing come alive. Remember, you have to make your academic writing come alive by putting it into a narrative, by presenting it as something that you have found. You must come into your academic writing and say, I am saying this on the basis of what I have discovered. And that discovery should have some kind of excitement, just as the excitement of a storyteller must have excitement. You must be very, very proud of what you have written, because your writing must be born out of real experience, real hard work. After several years of work, you have come to some discoveries. And you are excited about these discoveries, which you are going to present before the reader. So your narrative must include that excitement without making it look non-academic. It must have excitement, but that excitement must not be allowed to run free, like without any license, you know. Then it will seem to be very unruly writing. No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that there should be an element of pride in what you have found out in your writing. And that pride must be reflected in the narrative of your thesis, in the narrative of your book, that you have discovered something. And it is that pride which will take your make your writing more effective and more convincing. Because it is not merely putting together facts, but it is putting together facts with a certain element of pride, which makes the reader more interested in you. So the rules of your subject are given to you by the language which has been used by other people in your subject, by the discourse which your subject has been able to formulate. You get the rules of whatever subject you are working on, working in. You know, you get those rules through the earlier people, through the narrative, through the discourse. All this is very important for any book that is to be written. Okay, now we come to some other aspects. And remember one golden rule of writing, any book that you write, it should be written in the simplest possible language. The more complex language you try to use, the less intelligible you will be, the less the reader will want to read you. We all like simple people. You can use complex concepts, but they have to be described in very simple words. So rule number one, use very simple words. Rule number two, use short sentences. Use simple words, short words, and simple sentences and short sentences in order to be able to convey complex thoughts and ideas. There is a difference between a thought and an idea. A thought is something that comes into your mind randomly, but an idea is a formulated thought. When you have worked on your thought for some time, then it becomes an idea. And this idea must come into your academic writing with the use of simple short words and simple and short sentences. These ideas which you have formulated must come clearly into your writing. Now, I said they must come clearly into your writing. So one important is clarity. Whatever you say must not be ambiguous. It must not equivocate. It must not have double meanings. It must have clarity. Of course, clarity is a very difficult thing. We think we are clear, but contemporary theories tell us that we are not that clear. So we have to do extra work. Think of all those things which will remove any kind of ambiguity. Because as we speak, what happens is we think that we are reading a book, but the book is reading us. So as we are speaking, we are being read also. by so many different minds, and every mind is different. So we have to try and make everything simple, clarify things, make things very logical, and make them precise. This is the first characteristic, I would say, or element of academic writing, that it should be clear, precise, and logical. Then it should be objective. Objective is again a very odd word. What is objective? We say you should be very objective in what you say, but it is impossible to be very objective because every person is a subject with a different world in which he lives, with a different culture, with different values. So for him to be very objective is different. Objectivity is a myth. It is never achieved. And yet in academic writing, we have to try to be as objective. That means we have to merge ourselves into the tradition of our subjects. We have to put ourselves, you know, like you put your shirt onto a peg when you take it off. You have to take off your subjectivity and put it onto the peg of your subject, which is objectivity, and let it be seen from there. You know, let the subject and the object be so combined and constantly keep referring to whatever may be misunderstood in your understanding. All right? That is important. Now, there are two kinds of language, basically. One is denotative and one is connotative. Denotative language is the language of science, which has only one meaning. We imagine, at least the scientists also imagine, that what they say has only one meaning. But actually, contemporary theories tell us that all language has several meanings. But anyway, there is one kind of language which is more denotative because it aims at having a single meaning. But there is another kind of language which is connotative, which like the literary use of language, which has several layers of meaning. So the academic writer should try to remain denotative rather than connotative to as great an extent as it is possible for him to do. And then academic writing is discursive, as I have already said. It must conform to the terminology and conceptual understanding of a particular subject. So it must have that context. It must have the context or the contextual understanding of whatever has been said in the past. And now one very important thing about an element of today's academic writing. Every subject is a discipline. And we are supposed to write in according to that discipline. But in today's world, most knowledge is becoming interdisciplinary. It is combining all the disciplines, all the subjects. It is becoming interdisciplinary. And that is why just writing with our own subject in mind is not sufficient. Because tomorrow someone from another subject might want to read what you have written in this subject, and he may want to, or she may want to combine the two subjects together. So your language must also take into account the discourses of related subjects. You cannot afford to be isolated today. Today's scholar cannot say, I am just a historian, so I will be blind to what economics says. I am just a political scientist, so I will not consider what history has to say or what psychology has to say. All right. You have to be conscious of everything. We are living in a world where knowledge, all knowledge is our province. You will be surprised that Bacon in the 16th century, Francis Bacon, could say, I have taken all knowledge to be my province. Now, what a great mind he must have had, because he could say in the 16th century that I'm not only going to write as a literary author, I'm not going to write only as a philosophical author. I'm not going to write as a scientist, but I'm taking all knowledge to be my province. This is what the contemporary academic writer has to do. He must be conscious. His work is much more difficult than the work of earlier authors. Maybe even they were as conscious, but today they are being made very conscious of the fact that if you are not aware of what is happening in the contemporary world in other subjects, then your writing is but half complete. It is not a complete kind of writing. And that is why, you know, disciplinary and interdisciplinary work is significant in academic writing. Whatever you write will have a content. Whatever you write will have a significant content. It will be debated upon in the future. Therefore, whatever you write has to be greatly researched. You cannot write anything without being serious. You must have worked a lot about whatever you say. You must say whatever you say with authority, and authority comes with hard work. If you have not read, you will never be able to speak in the voice of authority because you have not read. You will always be shaky. So your writing will also be shaky if you have not read enough. So you have to constantly keep reading. And this is a prayer from me to you. If you want to be very good writers, if you have to be good and effective academic writers, you have to read a lot. Without reading, without researching, without, you know, analyzing what you have read, and without being critical of what you have read, you cannot write a good thesis. You have to do all these things. It seems that someone's thesis is so easily written. But if it is so easily written, then it is not a thesis. It is just, you know, a collection of pages with something written on it. A thesis is a thesis when it is researched and narrated with a feeling of pride and authority. Only then does it become a thesis. So, after telling you all this, I come to the next thing, and that is the question of voice. Your writing must acquire a voice. Just as literary writers have their own voices, even good academic writers must have some kind of voice. So what is voice? I must tell you this to make myself very clear. Your voice is your inner you. Whatever you feel from within after having read so much is your voice. Whatever you have felt internally, you have to externalize that through academic writing. You have to bring that out. And that is meant by bringing your voice out. Now, how do you bring your voice out? There are very few people who will be able to tell you this. If they are not writers of fiction, as I am, you know, I write fiction. So I can tell you, and I'm also a professor of literature, so I know how the voice has to be brought out. And I know what a writer, an academic writer, needs to do to bring out his voice. So please pay attention to what I'm going to say now. You know, we keep reading for years and years. I have read very seriously as an academic for about 50 years or more. And what I read 50 years or 40 years or 30 years or 20 years ago I may not be able to remember properly. But all that has been settling down somewhere in my subconscious mind. I may not remember it, but it has not gone away from me in my subconscious mind. All that has gradually been settling down, you know, like dust of layer keep settling down and they harden and they become a rock ultimately. Layers of dust keep settling and they become hardened into a rock. Similarly, whatever I have been thinking or reading has settled somewhere in my mind, in my subconscious mind. And that suddenly comes into my conscious mind at a particular time. When I write something, I write with a lot of concentration with my conscious mind. But as I'm writing consciously, some of that, those ideas which have been lying latently dead in my conscious, subconscious mind, they keep cropping up gradually. You know, like dolphin keeps like, just like dolphins keep jumping out of the sea, these ideas keep jumping out of the subconscious layer in the mind and they come into the conscious mind. And then, as I write consciously, the subconscious ideas also join in with the conscious writing. Together, whatever the subconscious mind dictates to the conscious mind is the voice of an author. Whatever the author says from his innermost self, combined with his conscious self, that is what is his voice. So every author must speak from his inner self combined with his conscious self of what he's writing here and now. These two things must, he should be so much a part of his writing. He should be so absorbed in his writing. He should be so much lost in his writing that his subconscious mind begins to dictate to his conscious mind. And the subconscious as well as the conscious become one and the same. Then the writer writes with a lot of feeling. He writes even an academic concept with a lot of feeling. And that becomes very, very powerful and effective. And that is what people begin to accept. You know, today, there are lots of style sheets like the MLA style sheet, like the APA style sheet, etc., which keep telling us that you have to, you know, curb yourself and use these particular formats so that you are understood. Various subjects have their own style sheets. So whatever is very personal to you will be sort of disciplined by a particular style sheet. So you must use these style sheets, understand them very well before you start doing your academic writing, because they will curb the tendency to, you know, run away with your excitement. They will curb you a little and they will put you in a certain format so that your scholarly writing will be more understood because it is being written in the format of a particular, you know, way of writing, knowledgeable writing. Okay. Now let me tell you about certain other kinds of writing quickly. I've got very little time left, so I will try to conclude this quickly. You see, first of all, the academic writer must be conscious of the fact, if he's a scholar of history, he must know that he is not a historian. He's only a scholar of history. The style of a historian is different. And the style of the academic writer of history will be different. Remember that history is not very different from fiction. This is what contemporary theories tell us. History is not very different from lies. Why? Because if there are 10 historians talking about the same subject, you will have 10 different views on it. Just as if there would be 10 literary writers describing one particular event or putting that one in event into stories, there will be 10 different stories. So it is we, our subjective selves, which, you know, right. So the scholar of history has to be an interpreter, basically. People believe that history is just a collection of facts about the past. No, this is wrong. History is not a collection of facts about the past. It is the view of a particular person. And remember, the views of historians are guided by the governments that rule a particular country at the time when that history is written. No historian will be able to write against the government because they will be afraid of, you know, facing hard times after having written. Very few historians will be brave enough to write exactly what they have felt about a particular age. So the scholars of history have to write after taking into account that history was not written in a very factually true manner. It was written because of certain pressures under which it was written, and because of certain physical limitations of a historian. Okay. Similarly, you know, journalism has its own language, which is different from academic language. Remember, we are living in the age of post-truth. In the 21st century, things should not be believed in easily because we are living in a world of lies. We are living in a world of fake news. We are living in a world when television channels and newspapers are giving us certain edited views of things. They are not giving us true opinions. So the language, academic writing, has to be different to journalistic writing. Because the writing in a newspaper is edited by the people who own the newspaper, who will not want to oppose the government. Or they are writing with certain aims in mind. They may have been paid by certain institutions to put up their point of view. Therefore, journalistic writing cannot be trusted. It has always to be taken with a pinch of salt. But academic writing should not land itself in the slush of journalistic writing. You know, journalism is something, again, very much like literature. A number of journalists have made very good novelists. You know, Charles Dickens was a journalist, and he was a very great novelist because he just shifted from that into novel writing, and he just maintained that, because these are just narratives, and narratives are never true. They have a lot of subjectivity in them. So journalism has a lot of, you know, lies in it. Remember that whenever a person is doing literary writing, he's trying to persuade you. And he is doing two things. He's saying things, but he's also showing you things through metaphors, through dialogues. He's showing you things. Because what can be shown cannot be stated, according to the German philosopher Wittgenstein. You cannot show what you can say or state. You cannot state what you can show. So in order to show things, one uses metaphor, one uses lies. You know, lies are metaphors. Metaphors are lies. When someone says he was a lion in the battlefield, that is a metaphor. He's lying because no one can be a lion. Everyone will be a man. He may be a strong man, but he will be a man. So lies comes from metaphors through literary writing. And journalism is equally, you know, metaphorical and full of images, alliteration for effect, and so many other sound effects. You know, literary writing uses a lot of sound effects. And whenever someone wants to write effectively, whether he's writing economics, psychology, history, or anything else, he tends to use language in which sound effects also start helping the sense of the words, where the words acquire sound and sense to convey a certain meaning. And this is why they tend to become literary. All language tends to become literary when it wants to be effective. Now, the academic writer will also become literary to some extent, but he must try to manage to become as little literary as possible. You know, in politics, the language of political science has to be different to the language of the politician. You know, the word politician has very derogatory connotations. No one wants to be called a politician. If someone is, suppose someone is a professor and I say, you know, this man is a politician, then it is almost like abusing this man. So no one wants to be abused. But a politician also has some very noble connotations. You know, if I say, well, this man is so noble, such a noble politician, then that means that he can be very good. And, you know, politics has its own ways. It has its own rhetoric. It has its own language. When someone says, I will get myself beheaded and I will give each drop of my blood for my nation, you know, this means nothing. He will neither get himself beheaded for his nation, nor will he give any drop of his blood for the nation. It is only rhetoric. So politics has its rhetoric, and political science must try to separate the rhetoric from political theory. It must make the difference between politics and political science very clear, even though sometimes political science is loosely described as politics. But that is not a very good description of political science. So ultimately, we have to use our imagination. We have to use our reason. We have to use our logic. We have to use our reading. We have to use our critical sense. We have to be conscious of how particular uses of language are different to academic use of language. We know that we will never be able to free ourselves entirely, but we should try our best to free ourselves from a literary use of language when we use academic language. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your words.
I invite questions from you.
Yeah, sir, we have a few questions from our audience at Google Meet as well as on YouTube. So to start with, I would take up a question from YouTube. Ms. Aparna P. asked this question. P. Aparna, sorry. The question
I'm sorry,
is,
I can't hear you.
Am I audible now, sir?
I'm sorry, okay. I can't hear anything.
Dhananjay, sir, could you please confirm if I'm audible to you?
Anirudh, you are audible. You're audible to me. You're audible.
The question is that what is the difference between academic writing and creative writing? I think the question here should be that can there be a junction of two? Right? So could you hear us?
I'm I'm sorry, I cannot hear anything.
Sir, can you listen to me? Am I audible, sir? Sir, am I audible, sir? Sorry? Anirudh, I believe we can write the question in the chat box.
Yes,
I can't hear anything. I'm sorry.
Dhananjay ji, Dhananjay, Dr. Dhananjay.
Yes, Dr. Chaube. Yes, please.
Kindly request sir to log off and rejoin.
Meanwhile, I would like to thank the audience for their continuous support. We
just wait.
We got an overwhelming.
Please wait.
What is the difference between academic writing and creative writing? The question was asked by Ms. P. Aparna.
All right. What is the difference? Remember, the difference between academic writing and literary writing is of degree rather than kind. All right. Because in order to be effective, you have to use narrative. You have to use all those devices which are used in literature. In order to be effective as an academic, you have to use certain literary devices, but
academic writing. And in the case of literary writing, you have your the words that you use will have both importance of sound as well as sense, whereas they will have both. There's someone ringing this one. So in academic writing, you know, you will naturally use logic, precision, clarity, and all that discourse of a particular language. But when you write creatively, then the whole world is your discourse. Then you don't have to limit yourselves to the discourse of a particular subject. I think I have made myself clear. Have I?
That's what I think the answer is received by the listener at YouTube. Also, sir, moving on to the next question.
I have a question, sir. Sir, can I ask a question?
You can ask, but kindly drop your question
in
the chat.
I'm sorry, I cannot hear you again.
Okay, but please. I am asking a question. Where to begin the writing?
I can't hear you again. I think I'll have to log in again.
Sir, Dhananjay sir, can you just pass?
Well, I request the participants kindly drop your questions in the chat box. Don't fiddle with the screen of your device. Please write your questions in the chat box. We will pass it to the...
I'll log in again. Person. Can't hear anything.
Yes, sir. So the next question being raised is by Mr. Venugopal Janaswamy. The question is, it is found that in stamp papers, the writing terminology related to the concern of content is of some sort of technical nature. It is difficult for the common man to interpret it correctly, like a seller or a purchaser of properties. So is it required to incorporate such?
Well, the language on a stamp paper is not academic writing. We are talking about academic writing. If someone does not understand that, for him, that stamp paper is no more than any other object. He just has to do the work that someone who's making him write that will explain to him. I really don't know about this question because it doesn't relate to the basic lecture.
Yes, sir. Okay. I myself had a question. Could I ask it, sir?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir, you mentioned about being a part of the general ocean. So, according to me, what I feel is if anyone portrays anything in the form of writing or a speech, he or she tends to connect it with his culture or something related to his own life. At that very moment, he restricts himself or herself from connecting himself to the entire audience. It might happen that the issue gets, the content gets related to only a few. Only a few gather what's written, right? So what should one do in order to prevent such things?
Can you just... give me a simpler question. I've understood about what you are saying, but you're talking about the general ocean and the culture in which one writes.
Yeah, sir.
When you write, you should be more conscious of the discourse of your discipline and also of the interdisciplinary discourse in existence. Because there is a very wide ocean for the creative writer, for instance. You know, he doesn't have a particular discourse only to follow, though there is something which is called literary also, which is related to the use of language. But in the case of someone who's doing academic research, particularly, he should try to keep as close to the discourse of his subject as possible. That means he should keep as close to the contextual knowledge of his subject as possible. That is all you can do. You can never finally get your success because there will always be someone more successful than you. You know, there will finally be someone who will do it better than you. So we can try to do everything as we best can. But we should never believe that we have done the best that is possible because there will always be someone who will come and outdo us. That is what contemporary theories tell us. So we have to be as objective as possible, but that objectivity is a myth. All right? That is why I said that the contemporary world is a very despairing world because it always makes us feel that we cannot achieve everything that we want to achieve. It tells us that we cannot understand everything that we want to understand. We cannot say everything that we want to say. But we have to just keep making an attempt to be better, to do something with fewer interpretations, to write something with fewer interpretations. That is all we can try to do. Okay.
Yeah. Let's move on to the next question then, sir. Mr. Bhaskar yes. Chetri has asked, sir, how can the researcher maintain the individual's voice consistently in a work that is too much dominant of the narrator's voice?
Well, the narrator is the one who's writing. They are not two different people. You know, your research is a narrative and you are the narrator. The scholar is the narrator. So he has to first do his research. He has to do all the reading and the finding out and, you know, meeting different scholars, going to different libraries and all that, collecting a lot of data and putting it into his mind. And then he has to finally be the narrator. So the narrator is the one who writes. You can ask another question connected to your question, Mr. Chetri, if you wish, if I haven't made myself clear.
Anirudh, he has posted one more question. If you could see in the chat box, Bhaskar has posted one more question. Can you see it? Should I read
it? Yes, sir. So, the next question by the same person is, can you tell us something about the novel, The Tailor's Needle? It vividly talks about the Raj era. So is it something more than creative writing or being written by an academician? Can we say if it has the elements of academic writing?
All right. Now, because this, The Tailor's Needle, is a novel that I have written myself. So, and because I'm a professor, my voice will not only be the voice of someone who's merely a novelist. It will always have something of academic value. And in The Tailor's Needle, there are some passages which deal with, you know, what is ideal education. There are some passages in which Sir Saraswati talks about what is ideal education. I've even forgotten what I have written because it was written so many years ago. But I remember that the Times of India of Delhi, you know, one of the editors had published an editorial on education, and they had quoted two paragraphs from The Tailor's Needle about what is ideal education in that. And so, you know, I forget exactly what I had written. So if I say that this is written in The Tailor's Needle, I will be telling lies because I don't remember what it must have been. It was written about 12 years ago or 13 years ago. But yes, the basic meaning of The Tailor's Needle is that one should be flexible. One should be able to pass through every kind of cloth without distinction. Good education makes a human being a flexible person so that he can pass through every kind of every kind of material and human situation. And that is what The Tailor's Needle basically says through this metaphor of The Tailor's Needle. And I'll tell you another thing. I was saying that when I wrote the Taylor's Needle, I was trying to help my students, undergraduate students, by writing a very simple novel for them so that they could understand it better.
All right, sir, let's move on to the next question. Question is by Ms. Rimpa Mondal. The question is, how much individual opinion in a research work is acceptable, and when does it become bias or an interference? How should one identify it?
Actually, how much is a difficult question, because how can you measure such a thing? It's difficult to measure. It's not a quantity.
I think there is some network issue. Anirudh, can you listen to me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I think there is some network issue.
Rationality is maintained. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
All right. So you can, if your logic and rationality are being maintained, then you can extend the personal element to any extent. But it should not go into fairy tale, you know, into a fairy tale. It should remain grounded in reality. That is important. Yes.
Yes, sir. The next question is by Ronak Singh. What's more important, the quality of experimental work or over the expressive English writings?
No, if you are writing for a subject which involves experiments, then naturally your experiments will give you the data. And in that case, that data has to be conveyed through academic writing very effectively, not shakily. If you are very confident about your experiment, about the rightness of your experiments, then you should be proud about that experiment and state it in a manner which is convincing, that is logically, precisely, and with a lot of pride. In those subjects where experiments are conducted, naturally your excitement should be curbed to a certain extent. But still, you should feel proud of what you are saying. And because you are proud of what you are saying, therefore your voice will have a sense of authority, because you have conducted those experiments. You have become a part of that experiment. And you will be able to say, I have seen that this happens. I can say with great conviction that this is what happens. So you will speak in a voice of authority.
Yes, sir. Let's move on to the next question. The question is, does flexibility mean being resilient in all situations?
Well, when you talk about flexibility, you're talking about the tailor's needle again, I think. Because I didn't talk of flexibility in academic writing. When I said flexibility, I was talking about the Taylor's Needle, my novel, the Taylor's Needle. And I said that flexibility, that everyone
Yeah, sir, I think we have some network issues again. We would like to, we would like to thank, I think, sir, we have some network issues.
I believe Anirudh, let him rejoin at least, and then we'll conclude.
Yes,
let's
sir.
Extend the thanks, and then we can conclude and announce the next session also, which will begin at 1:15. Till he joins us, just inform the participants about the next session. Anirudh, sir has joined. Yes.
Yes. Now I can hear you. Yes. Yes. I can hear you now. Yes. Yes.
Anirudh?
Yes.
Sorry for so many problems that are occurring. Yes. 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 Yes.
Yes, sir. The last question for today.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We can hear you now, sir.
Yes, 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 yes.
So the last question for today's session is there any basic difference in approach in literature and other subject as that of social science?
Yes, of course, there is a lot of, because every literature has its own discourse, its own basic terms, its own literary, you know, techniques, whereas social sciences have their own terminology, their own discourse. Only the person who's writing must use a narrative from beginning to an end, because a narrative can, you know, links all the chapters of a book or a thesis. So by using a narrative, you are actually linking all your chapters together, because you are speaking in your voice about all the things that you are saying in your various chapters. Therefore, that is very important. Otherwise, you cannot write a thesis of social sciences like you write a thesis of literature, because they have different, you know, different discourses. They have a they have different contexts in which they are written.
Yes, sir. I think
only the way in which you write is similar. Well, thank you very much for having me in this conference. I think it's a very great conference which is being organized. And I'm sure that the speakers after me will be even better than me. And I was really impressed by all the speakers. For a very happy conclusion of your conference.
Thank you, sir, for your wishes and support. I would now invite DT Dhananjay, sir, to kindly address.
Thank you so much, sir. It was something which I cannot express in words. I was very nostalgic when I was listening to you. It was like I'm sitting in room number 3 on first floor in the department and attending one of your lectures. Thank you so much, sir. And yesterday we had a talk, and I was not very sure whether you will be talking to us today because of COVID-19. But today again, I have learned a lesson from you that to keep the promises, the commitment. And I hope that we'll again listen to you sometime in future. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, Dhananjay. Okay, thank you.
Anirudh, could you please announce about the next session?
Sure. Thank you all for joining us for this session. The next session would be from 1:30 p.m. and we therefore request you to kindly join us by 1:15. The session would be by Miss Caroline Campbell. She would be deliberating on the topic, the role of academic writing, how it can help your career. We would also be having various sessions on the next 2 days also of the workshop, and we expect you for your constant support as it has been until now.
Right, and I personally request all the participants kindly please join us before 15 minutes.
Excuse me, may I just interrupt? Excuse me, sir. May I